guy talk about?
Well, thank you all for coming. I'm guessing that none of you need that profound introduction to Yoshio Ikezaki or his work. And he's actually a pretty good backgrounder in the latest issue of October's issue of Japanese Cultural News, copies of which are on the table. but I would like to commence our discussion, our little seminar, with the first paragraph of the essay I just wrote for Yoshio-san on the occasion of his exhibits here in Los Angeles this year. Born, raised, and educated in Japan, Yoshio Ikezaki has been living and working there on a full-time basis. But his career is intimately involved with Southern California, where he lived and taught for many years, and where he is now returning to work and to exhibit. Ikezaki is shown here frequently, and even more notably, has educated several generations of art students in the arts of papermaking and painting in Sumi inks, as well as in Japanese aesthetics and philosophy. Los Angeles and its art scene continue to remember and honor Ikezaki, who himself studied in Florida as well as in Japan. This year alone, 2017, he has been shown in one-man exhibitions at Art Center College of Design, where he taught for many years, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art's Japanese Pavilion, and the newly established Kylan Gallery in Beverly Hills, which is where we are meeting now. Indeed, 2017 has been a kind of Ikezaki year in Los Angeles, providing audiences with different views of a varied yet consistent and always gripping third book. Given that context, I'd like to ask Yoshio-san, what do you feel is your relationship to contemporary artistic practice, both here and in Japan? You work in traditional Japanese media, but you create very modern objects. How do they come out of your Japanese experience, and how do they come out of your American experience?
Try my best. And first of all, I thank you so much for your coming today and share with us. And I hope that we're going to have a very meaningful time together. For the Peter's questions about probably I understand how the difference between Japanese and the Western maybe, educations and cultures. And my background that I studied, I started studying Sumi ink painting was a very private learning tutor living in the southern part of Japan. I was 10 years old. And he had a 10 kind of disciple in his house, old man, taking care of him. And I'm the only kid. I was 10 years old. And I don't go there every day, but going like every Sunday. My mother wanted to go. So I start sort of understand the idea of what art is about. And in that very interesting situation, because Japanese art are not like a Western art. It's a lot sort of close to like a crafts-oriented sort of world. And when I start doing painting with Mr. Kusaka, he told me how to paint bamboos, which one of the four subject matters that everybody have to start. And bamboo is one of the fundamental subject matters that you have to study, and then orchid and chrysanthemum and the club. Anyway, I was very surprised to find that the strokes or something that he tells me, and I have to do exactly the same. And of course, it's, you know, I understand. But I did 5 years only in Bamboo. And he actually collected me all the time for 5 years. And I felt, what is the reason that he had to collect me on my own? At the same time, I started to feel that maybe this is the way to learn something so deeply. And I was looking around the other disciple of him doing kind of the same thing. Because I was so young that I could not see or to understand much deeper meaning of it. So I grew up with this kind of things, and then I met a lot of other artists, but who are very much like related to craft people. They have very little freedom to make their artwork look like them, rather than many other people doing it from them. You know, my point is that in craft, like say traditional Japanese craft, it have to be 100 years old at least, and then you can't really make like forms or like ideas that you want to put it in, like what Western world that teaches students with lots of freedoms. So this much of like a little space you have to put it in your identity and your, let's say, inventions. Right? But this is still going on in Japan in maybe in many ways. Of course, we have a lot of contemporary art and education, you know, in Japan. But because I taught in university in Tokyo for many years, and I've seen lots of students. They're almost like taught by professor or teachers who teaches how to do it, and they don't have much of the means to really create something so free that make them surprised. I'm talking about much more craft, okay, a part that we entered with Japanese education. And I came to USA because I wanted to finish with the place that I had only painted bamboo. So I wanted to change, and some people told me that when you come to America, maybe you can study everything so direct, and you can make something without no interruptions. And I came to Florida when I was 20 years old. My English wasn't very good at all. But I was taking art classes, and I realized that, yeah, that's so true, that this country has so much freedom to make. And this couple of years at that time, in 1975 or 6, I enjoyed so much because I feel like I'm a fish in a big pond, that's right? Then 2 years I did oils and acrylic and everything. And then I started wondering, something that not as I expected, because maybe too much freedoms that I can do. I could not really focus on something that I wanted to do, but rather I was looking at all other people's doing so many different things, and it just made me confused. So I have to think, let me put myself together, and I opened up my ceramic painting box. And I thought it was I gave up, but I did start again. So, you know, many years I have very strong idea of Japanese aesthetic and philosophy-based sort of artistic sort of creation. But at the same time, my being in the USA, especially in Southern California for so many years, many taught me how to be free. So naturally, I think my artwork tried to establish the dialogue between these two opposite sort of approach to the education or even to the human relations. I try to kind of understand myself and how to not really compromise it, but in a way, my dialogue to be established in very specific individualistic way, which maybe little by little, I painted some ink and tried to change. And the meantime, I studied paper for 6 years. I back in Japan after my master's, and I get into that very strong traditional way of learning, which is my master paper maker told me, Yoshio, you're artist, but you don't come here. Mm-hmm. Because artist, you don't need it, because artists always do what they want. Paper here to produce and to sell. So you must make exactly the same papers.